is Todd Kimball, and I will be your MC today. What a fine group of rested faces I see this morning. It's as though you all had an extra hour of sleep. Humanism is a rational philosophy, informed by science, inspired by arts, and motivated by compassion. It advocates for the extension of participatory democracy and the expansion of an open society, standing for human rights and social justice.
Take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbirds singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to be free. Blackbird, fly. Blackbird, fly. Into the light of the dark, black night. Singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. You were only waiting for this moment to arise.
Our guest today is backed by popular demand. He spoke to us back in August with the program, The World to Which Darwin Led Us. The American Blackbirds, a family of nearly 100 species, is remarkably diverse in ecology and social behavior, not unlike the Portland humanists. Gordon Orleans has had a lifetime love affair with blackbirds. He will guide us on our tour. He is a Professor Emeritus of Biology at the University of Washington. He has served as their Director of Environmental Studies. His most intensive research area has been behavioral ecology. Let's have a warm yet muted HTP welcome for Gordon Orleans.
Good morning, good morning. That's wonderful, that song that was just played. That's the European blackbird, which is not one of the American blackbirds. But as you probably all know, that is a wonderful anti-slavery song. And it was written in America when he observed the slavery. But I want to talk to you about the American blackbirds, which does not include the European blackbird and a lot of other things. But before I get into that, I just want to say a few things. One is that this talk is simply about the wonders of science. And I think one of the most wonderful gifts that anybody can get is the gift of understanding. And that's what science gives us. And I'm going to be talking about just the gift of understanding. And it's what I'm going to talk about, according to my aunt Hortense, doesn't have any a great social importance. It's simply the wonder of what birds can do and the wonder of understanding. But before I go on any further, I'm talking about the blackbird family. Well, what is a family? When I say the blackbird family, and it's nearly 95 species or so, what is a family? That I need to go for a few minutes into how our classification system works. All classification systems are information retrieval systems. They help us understand what we're looking at. And the more you know about the system and what you're trying to, the more understanding you get out of it. And the early classification, biological classifications may seem strange today. The plant classifications were all based on the diseases that you could use the plant to cure. And the animal classifications look really bizarre to us today. Those that disappeared into the mud in the winter and a few crazy things. But once evolution was established, it was decided that our classification, biological classifications, should try to reflect evolutionary relationships. We want to group together into various groupings, things that are closely related, that is, they have recent common ancestors. And so now all biological classifications attempt to do that. And so the family Icteridae, the blackbird family, when we say that's the blackbird family, we're saying that all those species that are in the family, if we trace back to a common ancestor, an Ur blackbird, which long extinct, we don't know what that Ur blackbird ever looked like, but and we probably never will because birds don't leave many fossils. And so that, but we think when I say the family, the blackbird family, we hope that it includes all the descendants of that Ur blackbird that are alive today and nobody else. And if we discover that somebody else that we thought was a blackbird, then we discover that it isn't, you take it away and put it somewhere else. The most striking recent one in birds may be that what we're calling summer tanagers and scarlet tanagers aren't tanagers at all. The new DNA evidence says they're grosbeaks. So they've been moved out of the tanager family, although we're still going to call them tanagers. So the evidence, we're trying to get things to reflect evolutionary relationships. And so when I'm talking about the blackbird family, to the best of our knowledge, all the surviving members descended from that Ur blackbird are in the family and nobody else is there. And of course, a lot of blackbirds existed since the Ur blackbird that survived for a while and went extinct. We'll never know what they were. But if we do find fossils of any of them, we'll put them in the family. So that's what the family is. And it's one of the hierarchical classifications in our system. And I won't bother unless we want to get into it in the discussion of all the different levels, but that's hierarchical. And again, these classification systems are information retrieval systems. So, and if I tell you something is an orchid, that tells you a whole bunch of things that I don't have to say anything more than that if you understand something about the system. So the reason I fell in love with blackbirds in the beginning was that I was interested in the relationships between social systems and the environment. And I wanted to study a group of birds, and I got hooked on birds when I was a kid, so it was going to be birds, that show a lot of different variations in social systems. And the blackbirds are just wonderful because almost every kind of social system that any bird species had, some blackbird has it. And I'll try to share some of that with you as we go along looking at the blackbird. So that I got interested in this and looking at social systems and the blackbirds, and then it turns out they're useful for a lot of other things. And so I spent a life looking at a lot of different things that blackbirds do. But the point is that blackbirds are highly variable, and I'm going to try to share this with you. And what we've learned about, in general, about animal social systems and the evolution of social systems that blackbirds have helped us to understand. So, 490 blackbirds, there are roughly 95 species plus or minus in the blackbird family. And that's why the title, and I've based it on, you know, the 490 blackbirds baked in a pie, which is also the European blackbird, which is not an icterid blackbird. And it's also the blackbird singing in the dead of night and the Beatles song. And that's it's a robin, of all black robin that hops around on the lawns in Western Europe. So so it's not what I'm talking about, but as I like to say, not all blackbirds are black, and not all blackbirds are blackbirds. Are there any questions? Okay, so the 490 blackbirds, let's, are we here? And probably the most, and let me say a couple other things, apologize for the slides. These are rather old and I took all of them and they're not modern quality. And the drawings in, that I will show you are all by Tony Angel, a Seattle bird artist. And he and I collaborated to produce a book, Blackbirds of the Americas. And I wrote all the words and took the pictures, and he did all the artwork. And so we'll see some of Tony Angel's wonderful artwork. Probably the most familiar of all the blackbirds is the red-winged blackbird, the displaying male shown here. The red-winged blackbird is one of the most common birds in North America, and its breeding range extends from Southeast Alaska to Costa Rica. This is the territorial male, and this is a male that is trying to attract a female, displaying this way in the cattail marshes where most of the red-winged blackbirds actually breed. And another common blackbird in Washington and Oregon in the drier areas is the yellow-headed blackbird. And here is a male displaying on his territory. And you can see he also, they're nesting in mostly in cattail marshes like the red-winged blackbird. And this is just a resting male. So you can see, unlike the male red-winged blackbird that can cover up the red, he can't do anything about his yellow head. It shows all the time, but he's got white flashes in his wings, which he can cover up. And this is a female yellow-headed blackbird that doesn't look anything like the male. All she has a little bit of yellow. And she weighs about half of what the male yellow-headed blackbird weighs, and the female red-winged blackbird weighs about half of what the male plays. And I will describe a little bit later when we see dramatic differences in size of male between males and females, we know something rather interesting in social organization is going on. Very closely related and almost identical to the red-winged blackbird is the tricolored blackbird, which is one of the most highly, is the most highly colonial songbird in North America. This is a breeding colony in an alfalfa field in the Central Valley of California. This breeding colony, which I happen to study, had about 100,000 nests in it. This bird is now endangered because of everything we've done to the Central Valley of California. So these are two male yellow-headed blackbirds, red tricolored blackbirds, and you can see they're packed densely, and the males do defend a little territory, but it's a few feet on a side, and they pile into these areas, highly different social system. And this is what I actually did my doctoral dissertation on, because I thought, here's something that are almost totally different, but they look almost alike and obviously are extremely closely related. The tricolored blackbird is a narrow range, unlike the red-winged blackbird, was originally found only in California. It has spread northward a little bit, and there are now a few breeding colonies in eastern Oregon and eastern Washington, but the center of the breeding range of this bird is in California, the way it's always been. We go around the world a little, but if we go down to South America, in Argentina, this is the yellow-winged blackbird, which is sort of the ecological equivalent to our yellow-headed red-winged blackbird. And this is the female of of that species, which looks a lot like a female red-winged blackbird. If I showed that to you and told you that was the female red-wing, you probably couldn't tell the difference. Also down there, it's interesting, is the scarlet-headed blackbird. So the colors are reversed. The The yellow-headed blackbirds are red, the red-winged blackbirds are yellow, and as we'll see in a minute, the yellow-breasted meadowlarks are red in South America. The scarlet-headed blackbirds, this is a displaying pair. The males and females look alike, and they're roughly the same size, and that already tells us a lot about how different they are from the yellow-headed blackbird, where if you go to the guidebooks for the South American birds, you need only one picture of a scarlet-headed blackbird. You don't need two because the males and females look alike. And another one of the blackbirds that isn't black is the brown and yellow marsh bird, very common bird in the marshes of and wetlands of temperate South America, very common bird in Argentina, where I had the privilege of studying it. It's a very different looking bird, and it has a communal breeding system with multiple birds are feeding babies in a single nest. And here's another picture of the brown and yellow marsh bird where you can see the belly better. And just a tour of some of the other blackbirds. This is the Austral blackbird, all black, and this is the blackbird that goes further south. Its breeding range extends all the way down to Tierra del Fuego at the southern tip of South America. And it's all black, like a good blackbird ought to be. And it happens to be a pretty good singer. A very narrow endemic blackbird that breeds in these arid valleys on the east side of the Andes in Bolivia, and nowhere else is the Bolivian blackbird. It is the only blackbird known to nest in crevices and cliffs. And I've discovered the first nest, which I'm here probing. And you can see this was quite a few years ago when my hair was both more luxuriant and a very different color than it is now. So this is interesting, the variable nest size. This blackbird breeds in these holes in the cliffs, and no other blackbird breeds in anything like that. This is the melodious blackbird, another one of the all black ones that has the name implies, is a very, very beautiful song, and sometimes used as a cage bird. It's a bird in Central America, breeding in open countries. There's another species closely related to it in Chile, and still another one in Cuba. And these are all black blackbirds, and they're quite different than some of the others. Another section of the blackbird family are the grackles. And this is the Lesser Antillean grackle, displaying in a pine tree in Puerto Rico. The grackles, we have grackles in the grackle group in North America, and we don't happen to have any one of the grackles in Washington state, but the Brewer's blackbird, which we do have, is very closely related to this. And there's a displaying male pair of Antillean grackles, typical bill-up posture, and the grackles have very big tails that are a part of their display system. As I mentioned, the meadowlarks in South America, the meadowlark is a blackbird, it's not a lark. We have two species in North America, and both have yellow breasts, and there are several species in temperate South America, and this is one of them, and you see the blackbirds, the meadowlarks in temperate South America have red breasts, otherwise they look and act just like ours. And in the tropics, then, among the blackbirds that are very interesting are the ones that we call caciques. The cacique is a Spanish word that means chief, and oropendulas. And these are the largest of the blackbirds and highly colonial. These are two of them there. And they build, that was the yellow red-bellied grackle. But these are the nests. And one thing that is very typical of the blackbird family is many of the species are very elaborate weavers of nests that are highly pendant. And these are the nests of a palm tree of that blackbird. And this introduces what we get into with something that is very typical. This is the black and yellow cacique. very common in from Panama down south, nests in dense colonies in trees. And this is very typical of a lot of the, its nests are dependent, but this happens to be an oriole's nest. And yes, orioles are blackbirds, we'll come to that. They're among the very effective weavers of these nests. This is the colony of the Montezuma oropendula. The oropendulas, a number of species ranging from Central America down through South America. These are big, they're crow-sized blackbirds, highly colonial and big pendant nests. This is a nesting colony in Costa Rica of the Montezuma oropendula. And this is another nest. And if you travel down through Central America, one of the most conspicuous features in the countryside are the big colonies, the nests of these oropendulas. And one thing that's interesting about this is you can see they're not worried about predators coming from the air. They're very, very worried about predators coming from the ground. And so the nests are up very, very much on the tips of the branches. They try to nest in the open because the most important nest predators on these birds are monkeys and snakes. And these are very, very difficult for the monkeys and the snakes to get to. So they like isolated trees and they get out as far in the branches they can get. And often they get out so far that sometimes they break off. There weren't quite enough left to support them. So another group that is in the blackbird family are the orioles. They were called orioles because there's a European oriole that's yellow and black. And when the Europeans or the British got to America and they saw these things were yellow and black and orange and black, they said, ah, they're orioles. They have nothing to do with the oriole of the old world, which is good. Quite a different, it's also a songbird, but not closely related, which is to say they don't have a common ancestor and go way back. This is the troupial, one of the most common of the orioles in South America. And there's a whole bunch of orioles, and I'll just show you, these are Tony Angel paintings, that orioles are variations on a particular color pattern. And we have a large number of species. They reach the greatest richness of species is in Mexico and northern Central America, but they also go into South America. And of course, we have some species coming as far north as Washington. But these orioles are variations on these patterns. And these tropical orioles, I don't need to show you pictures of males and females because in the tropical orioles, unlike our highly migrant temperate ones, the males and females look alike. And so my apology for this, but again, these are two pairs of two different species of tropical orioles. And you can see the males and females look just alike. And I'll come back to why that might be the case. Also in the blackbirds, and I apologize that this spills over, are the cowbirds. And cowbirds are what we call brood parasites. That is, they lay their eggs in the nest of other birds and let other birds raise their babies. And this is a rare, but not widely distributed, actually, breeding pattern in birds. It was first discovered and is most famous in the European cuckoos that are long brood parasites. And we have dozens and dozens of species of old world cuckoos that are brood parasites. They've been brood parasites for a long time because they mimic the eggs of the host, and this marvelous thing going on. But the cowbirds are brood parasites, but they're much more recent. These are all the cowbirds. The big one in the center is the giant cowbird. And it parasitizes only oropendulas and caciques. On the lower left there is the baywing cowbird, and it actually raises its own babies, has its own nest, but the one that's cut up in the upper left, the top, is the screaming cowbird. It's a brood parasite, and its only known host is the baywing cowbird. The upper right that you don't see very well is the bronze cowbird, which is it's mostly in Central America, and it mostly parasitizes orioles. And then on the bottom are the are two species, the brown-headed cowbird on the lower right and the shiny cowbird. The brown-headed cowbird is the common one all over North America, and it parasitizes at least 200 species of songbirds. And the same is true of the South American one. These are highly Catholic, and they parasitize almost all species of songbirds. So this very, very interesting questions that this posed them. How did this all get started? How did it get started? You lay an egg and somebody else. These are the shiny cowbirds in South America on the ground. How did this ever get started? This has been a subject of interesting research, and a lot of this has been done with the brown-headed cowbird. There's also another interesting question to ask is then, how does the cowbird know it's a cowbird? Because it's been being raised by song sparrows or red-winged blackbirds, and that's all. It doesn't see anything of an adult cowbird around when it's growing up. How does it know that it's a cowbird? And so we know that in order for this to have evolved in the first place, it had to be that whoever was raised in somebody else's nest knows that it is who it ought to be, rather than a member of the species of what's taking care of it. And this is very important because we know that many birds learn who they are by who's around them when they first hatch and figure out who they are. And this was first discovered by the famous behaviorist Conrad Lorenz, and you've probably all seen pictures of the little baby ducks following him that he thinks they're his mother, and they think are their people. And this had a very practical importance because in an effort to try to get the whooping crane back, one of the things that was done was to put whooping crane eggs under sandhill cranes in Montana. The sandhill cranes raised the baby whooping cranes. They migrated together to the Texas coast. The problem was that the whooping cranes thought they were sandhill cranes, and they kept courting others, sandhill cranes, and unfortunately they had to get rid of them. So the evolution of this brood parasitism in birds depends on the fact that you actually know who you are, not who you don't learn from what was. And this is a nest of the yellow-winged blackbird, and you see the slightly larger speckled eggs are eggs of the shiny cowbird in that nest, and they get hatched and they get raised. So so one of the questions is why do birds accept then? You can see it's very obvious that what those eggs were, that they weren't your own. Why don't they kick them out? Well, the problem is they're very hard to get rid of an egg. If you're a small bird, you can't grab it. If you try to puncture it, you get a mess in the nest. Here's a female northern oriole, and she's a big enough that she's a puncture ejector, so she punctured the cowbird egg and has taken it out. But see, there's a problem. You're starting to puncture an egg in a nest, and you have a danger of puncturing your own egg. And so the evolution of rejection depends both on size and ability. So a lot of birds actually accept the cowbird eggs. It's impossible for them to actually get rid of it. What's so special, other than what I've just been talking about, is this family of birds. And what do we think is the key evolutionary innovation that underlines their great success? And it's called gaping. That is forcefully opening the bill against objects. And this is a male yellow-headed blackbird gaping under a cow pat, lifting it up by gaping it up and exposing the stuff that's underneath. Now, most birds have strong muscles for closing the bill. And these are some diagrams here. The black shaded muscles are muscles for closing the bill, and the dark black muscles are muscles for opening the bill. And most birds are like the lower right. You have very strong muscles for closing the bill because you're closing against prey, you're grabbing stuff, holding them on. And gravity will do most of the work of opening the bill. So the muscle that are to open the bill is rather small. That's what you see there. That's rather typical for most songbirds. In the upper left there, that's actually the situation in some of the blackbirds where they are gaping. And you can see that they still have the muscles there and slashed gray for closing the bill, but the muscle for opening the bill against the force is much larger. It's in solid black there. And this you can see the upper the species, there's a small little muscle on the left for opening the bill. And I'm sorry about it being off on the bottom. This is my fault. But we think this is extremely important, that gaping and ability to gape, and I'll explain a little bit more about that, has been critical for the success of the blackbirds. But before leaving that, I want to tell you a little bit more about birds' bills. Birds' bills just don't open and close. They do all sorts of other stuff. And you can see this little diagram shows that the lower mandible, which is not detached to the head, has muscles. It can not just open, it can change shape. And if you want to see how variable birds' bills are, what they can do, go to the zoo and watch parrots. Parrots will, the parrot bills can do a number of things. The way to see it is just go watch parrots' bills. So birds' bills are very adaptable and flexible. And not only can you open and close them, the lower mandible can be brought way down, opening up for stuff. And so allows you to do a lot of things with the bill. So this is just a diagram of showing what that can be like. Okay, these birds are doing a lot of gaping, and they're finding a lot of their prey by opening up spaces. And what we see, a lot of the color patterns reflect this. This is a color, it's an oriole blackbird up on the top and several species of orioles there. And they have dark color that goes from the eye to the bill because they're opening stuff and looking down the bill. And you don't want a lot of glare there. And this is just like what you see in baseball players or football players. You darken up the cheeks to cut the glare. Well, you can see these have evolved, these plumages that cut the glare. So it's very common for these blackbirds and a lot of other birds too. It'll be dark going from the eye down to the bill, and it cuts down glare. And you can also hear some of the oropendulas, the great big things, and they have an interesting position, and the pterids do, since you're opening the bill, by gaping and exposing prey, they have the ability, the eye focuses right to down to the tip of the bill. And so you have this icterid, this blackbird face, which allows them to look straight down the bill and focus on what might be made available by gaping and opening the bill. So we think that so much of what has made blackbirds successful is gaping, because orioles gape into fruits. You can split open stems, almost all sorts of ways that you can split open stuff and expose prey, which is not available to things that can't do it. And so our general feeling is that this has contributed enormously, this particular trait, developing the ability to gape, has enabled the blackbirds to utilize a whole bunch of resources that other birds can't get at. And we think this is available to a reason for their success. Another thing besides this little pattern going from eye to bill that's important in thinking about avian plumages is what we like to call concealable badges, that they have the bright colors that you can show them off, but when you don't want to show them off and be inconspicuous, you can cover them. You can see the yellow, brown and yellow marsh bird in the middle with the wing up to display. When you bring that wing down, it covers up all that yellow. And the lower lower left is a meadowlark, or and when it shows up in its yellow breast and belly and sings, it can be very, very conspicuous. All it has to do is crouch in the grass and it becomes very, very inconspicuous and can cover it up. So a lot of what we see in the bird plumage patterns is what we call coverable badges. You can show them off when you want to, and you don't have to show them off when you don't want to. And here's a male red-winged blackbird that doesn't want to show off his red, and it's covering up, and you don't see the red. And when they're flying around in the winter and they're not displaying, until they fly, you don't see the red. They're in the grass and working around. You may see a little bit of this yellow stripe below the red, but they can cover it up. So this is widespread in bird plumages, and what we call these coverable badges. And it's very advantageous to be able to show off when you want to show off, be very, very conspicuous, and to be less conspicuous when you don't want to show off. And so you can cover up your badge when you don't want to. A little bit about the ecology of these birds. As we saw from the beginning of the of my talk, the red-winged and yellow-headed blackbirds, which I've studied very intensively, are marsh nesting birds. And they're exploiting the emergence of insects from the marshes. And marshes are full of all sorts of insects that have aquatic larval stages and terrestrial adult stages. And they emerge and transform from aquatic to adult stages when they come out. And the time that they're emerging is when they're especially vulnerable. And so the blackbirds are timed for breeding. And this is the time of day and what the blackbirds, YH is yellowhead, RW is redwing, and BB is Brewer's blackbirds, three birds I studied in Eastern Washington. And you can see that, and what in the dark covering, those are all insects that have aquatic larval stages and terrestrial adult stages. And you can see that how important it is for all three of the species of birds. And odonata are the dragonflies and damselflies, and they're ones that come out and have, and when they're changing over from being a larva and an air breeding adults, they're very, very, very helpless. They can't move much, and that's when the blackbirds really clean up. And they emerge mostly in the morning, and you can see the red wings and the brewers are concentrating on that in the morning. The yellowhead is sort of an emerging insect specialist. And that is the explanation for why the yellow-headed blackbird is so much more restricted in its range than the red wing or the brewers, is that it's confined only to the really highly productive marshes. And in Washington, Oregon, the really highly productive marshes have tons of insects coming off our eastern Washington, and that's where the yellowhead is. So this is the result of a lot of sampling of, we developed a technique which was, I would go to a nest and put a little bit of a ring around the nest. I was using pipe cleaners, actually little sections of pipe cleaners, just tight enough that the bird could still breathe, but it couldn't swallow. And you leave it on for about an hour and come back, and all the food that the parents have delivered is there in the throat. And you can take it out and identify it, and it's in really good shape, hasn't been digested at all. And that's a rather bizarre technique. I never left it on more than an hour and didn't lose birds, but that's how all of this information is gathered. I'm a retired biology professor, and this slide just shows you that I haven't forgotten how to produce unreadable slides. So what I'd like to do is cut the slides right now, and I'm going to describe a few things that you can see in the slides, but it'd be much better if I just told you about the things. Some of the things we've learned about bird behavior and social organization just from looking at blackbirds. and looking more broadly. So if we can just cut the slides, cut them out, and put my beautiful face back on the screen. I'm just going to talk the rest out here. Thank you. Thank you. So I think it'll be better for me just to describe. So I've sort of hinted on several things that that we've learned from looking at the blackbirds and other birds that that tell us about what's going on, how we understand avian evolution. Now, the first thing is that I showed you some patterns, where males and females look just alike, others where males and females look very different, and others where the males are much, much, much bigger than the females. And that turns out to be very strongly correlated with the kind of social system. Birds that we know are monogamous, that is one male and female on the territory, there's very rare that one of the sexes is more than 10% larger than the other. Usually the males are between 5 and 8% bigger than the females, but that's all. When we see situations like the red-winged and the yellow-headed blackbirds, when the male weighs twice as much as the female, there's something else going on. And what is going on is that these are species in which then the males get multiple females. That is, they have harems. And so red-winged blackbird on territories, the males get an average of 2 to 3 females per male on the territories. And the record I had with one male that got a dozen females on his territory. And so you know that something else is going on, and that is this: have intense competition between the males for a limited resource, and the males gather multiple females, and this drives to very large males because very large size is favored in male-male competition. This works out where you have highly productive environments which are highly constrained, so that the males can defend these territories that have abundant resources. And a female then can benefit from becoming a second female on the territory of a male that already has a female, rather than going to forming a pair bond with a male that doesn't have a female yet, but on a poorer territory. And it's turned out that we've done a lot of work on this in various species, but the red-winged blackbird has been a key to this, that the reason this works out, that it is a female is better off being the second female or the third female on a territory of a male that has a really good territory than being the first female on a male that has a rather poor territory. So if we have great differences in the resources that are controlled by males, males can gather extra resource females from if they got really good real estate. The red-winged blackbird female has a much easier job than the human female does, because when she's forming her pair bond, she can look at the real estate that the male has. In bonding in human females, the guy doesn't have it yet, and you're trying to look at future resource holding potential of the guy. And it's a little bit harder than what the female red-winged blackbird has to figure out, because she can already see it. So when we see great differences in size between males and females, we know that certain males are highly controlling, especially valuable resources, and it pays females to be there with them, even though they sacrifice parental care. Because in red-winged blackbirds, the males mostly feed at nests, the females doing most of the feeding on their own without much help from the males. And this is possible only because the males are controlling this really highly valuable territory, the abundant insect resources. And the female, in fact, raises her nestlings all on her own, and she does a pretty good job. And we've been able to show by a lot of studies in the field that the second and third ranked or fourth ranked females in a harem do on average just as well as the first ranked females. So they're not paying a price for being second or third, because the insect resources are there and available for them. And in these marshes, there's the emergence of these insects every day during the breeding season. It's a resource that can't be depleted. It's not like a bunch of caterpillars on the trees, and when you eat them, they're gone. Every day, more insects come out of the water to transform, and they provide available food for the females, and it keeps coming and coming. And no matter how much you take today, that doesn't influence how many insects are going to be available tomorrow. So these are the kind of systems in which these pile up, and you get these harem systems in which females are gathering multiple females. Why is it so different down in Argentina? I did a lot of work on, and there's these marshes are not nearly as productive. There's not nearly as much stuff coming out. The male and female scarlet-headed blackbirds, which alike both participate fully in provisioning the young, there simply isn't enough resource there to support the status of the female becoming a second female in a territory of a male, because there's not that much difference in the resource providing ability of those territories. And this also relates to some of the most spectacular displays that we see in birds, where the manakins or the birds of paradise, where the males and females not only are totally distinct, but the males have absolutely nothing to do with the females other than providing some genes for their kids. And so the males are doing these big displays. And so what's going on is that all the female is getting from this male, not even a bit of resources, because the male doesn't control any territory. He's got this little display bower or something like that, which tells you something about his architectural abilities, but there's no resources there. So the female, say bird of paradise or bower bird, isn't getting any resources at all related to the male. All she's getting is genes. And so she's having to select for quality of genes. And so how do you know whether this guy is really good and whether he's healthy or not? They're all going to display to say they're wonderful. You make him go through the hoops. You exhaust him. And you've seen these incredible displays that the birds of paradise go through. And the females just sit and watch, and these guys go through these incredible dances and exhaust themselves. They may or may not be satisfied. They're going around sampling different males, because all you're going to get from this guy is genes. And one other thing that I might just mention, how come that it has gone to such incredible elaborations in the birds of paradise than anywhere else, is that the birds of paradise are on New Guinea, where there are viable terrestrial mammals. The birds have the canopy all to themselves. There are tree kangaroos, and there are a few in the Seattle Zoo. I don't know if you have any in the Portland Zoo, but the tree kangaroo is very awkward, they can't do very much. And one of the things that we're all worried about, if monkeys got into these systems, that would be the end for the tree kangaroos, because they simply would not be competitive. But what this means that in New Guinea, the birds of paradise have all the fruit to themselves, so abundant resource. And so the males can be spending tremendous amount of time there courting and building stuff. And they can go tank up on fruit very, very quickly and come back, so they can be there for days and days on end. And the females also have abundant resources. So the fact that there are no competing arboreal mammals means that natural selection has driven this, making the males go through such elaborate dances, has driven it further in New Guinea than anywhere else. So, and one of the reasons against the males coming bigger, they get to be the less than optimal size. They're fighting, they're competing against one another, they've gotten a lot bigger, than you would want to be for simply gathering resources. And we know there are several studies know that in males of these, they're much, much bigger than females. The males survive less well than the females during the winter. One of the first studies that was ever done was done with the bow-tailed grackles in Texas. And the birds, the grackles were coming into a big roost in the evening in a tree that didn't have any leaves. And the researcher took big pictures of all the birds in the tree. And the males are so much bigger than the females so that you could count, tell whether you had males or females in the tree. And over the course of the winter, he took pictures and shows that the males were disappearing at a much faster rate than the females. So there's counter selection as the males get bigger, the males do not survive as well. And how far that gets driven depends upon what the big payoff is. And with the red-winged and yellow-headed blackbirds, they can't drive it more than about twice as big as the female. But we know a lot then that the size differences between males and females tell something about the payoff from being bigger. And it also, we've learned out that it tells us something about the males pay a price for being bigger and they don't survive as well. So that in the species that are monogamous and both are taking care of defending the territory, feeding the babies, that tells us why in the monogamous species, the males are only slightly bigger than the females. And the reason they're probably slightly bigger is that in most cases, the males are playing a more active role in defending a territory. Another thing that I showed you was that for the highly temperate and migratory birds, that there were big differences between the males and the females in their plumage. And I showed you the for example, take the orioles, the tropical orioles. I showed you that all the tropical orioles, the males and females look just alike. And the bird guide shows only one picture because you don't need to. Our migratory orioles, the males are dramatically different, much, much brighter, and the females are duller. And this is a situation that the tropical orioles are going to form permanent pairs. And they're going to defend the territory and be around together all of the time. And they cooperate in defending the territory. And if one of them dies, then the other one can sing for a replacement and hope you can get a replacement before a roving pair that doesn't have a territory yet finds you out and kicks you out. So a lot of these tropical, including some of the tropical orioles, they have a duet, they sing duets. So the males and females are duetting, and they have different parts of the duet. So if one of the members dies and the other is singing, the song tells you which sex it is and what sex of partner you're looking for. So very intense dynamic in the tropical situation. In the highly migratory ones, they break up. There's no permanent pair formation. The pairs are reestablished every spring. The males come first, and they're actively defending the territory, and they're brighter, and they fight it out. And the females come, and they're dulls, and they don't have anything to do with, and they're simply cryptic. So the difference between where the males and females look very, very different in plumage, and where they don't, a lot of this, not entirely, but a lot of this relates to the permanence of pair formation, the roles of females and males in the system. And so if you see, looking at the museum skins, you can tell a lot about what's going on with the system simply by seeing how much bigger the males are from the females and how different they happen to look. So these are patterns that are well established there in blackbirds. They're widespread among other birds, but an awful lot of what we learned about how those patterns actually work are that they've been studied with the blackbirds because they're so common, they're so easy to study, and they're very, very convenient. So they've been excellent researchers. I've told you how important gaping is for blackbirds, and orioles gape into fruits, meadowlarks gape into grass tufts and open it up and they look right down to the stuff. caciques will gape open stems. Blackbirds and cattails will split open cattail stalks. An awful lot of stuff that you can make available prey that you can't see if you can't gape it open. It's very hard to see that. I can't tell you to go out and watch a blackbird doing it. But fortunately, there is another bird, which is not a blackbird and is actually an alien to North America, that is forages by gaping, and that's the European starling. So if you really want to see gaping in action, go out on the lawns and watch starlings, because you'll see them doing it, gaping to exploit stuff. They're doing and getting the same advantage that our blackbirds do. So gaping is not confined to the blackbirds, but it's such a characteristic thing of the blackbirds, and very few species otherwise and other families of birds are gapers. But if you want to see it, and it's easily seen on the lawns with the European starling, which is a very, very active and compulsive gaper. The blackbirds are, I raise some red-winged blackbirds and I feed them seed when they walk around my hand and they gape open my fingers. You know, they walk around, they're gaping, they're compulsive gapers, they can't help themselves. But it turns out that's a wonderful thing to do, because it exposes a whole set of food that is not open to somebody that can't gape. And then, of course, there are other ways that birds expose food, a lot of scratching and digging up stuff and other things that help birds expose and capture food that is not otherwise available. But gaping is just, it turns out to be effective in a wide variety of environments. You can, there's almost no environment in which you can't expose some sort of food that you can't see unless you gape. And so we believe that that's probably the one innovation that probably really drove the fact that blackbirds exploded from this ur-blackbird up to nearly 100 species that are among the most common birds in the environments where they occur, and ranging from Alaska to Tierra del Fuego. So I hope this little passage through the blackbird family will sort of show you how interesting it is and wonderful that what we've learned about these blackbirds. But I want to close with, I find that science is one of the most beautiful things that humans have ever developed. Science is the way we discover and learn about the world. I've just described to you a whole bunch of things we've learned about the wonderful things that blackbirds do and other birds, that it's science that has allowed us to discover this. And it's, science is just beautiful. It's the act of discovery. And I'm always dismayed that in my lifetime, the way we've supported science is because we're competing with somebody. And the first big defense spending where we threw money at science was when the Russians put up Sputnik and the Defense Education Act, and money poured into science because we got to keep up with the Russians. And then we had the Star Wars, and now we're pouring a lot of more money into science because we got to beat the Chinese. And that's not to say that science doesn't have something to do with competition. And it definitely plays a role there. But I think science is one of the most beautiful, creative things that we've ever discovered. And it's understanding. And one of the most wonderful gifts that we can get is understanding. And we now know, as a result of science, we've answered the big questions that people really care about. Where did we come from? How do we get here? Do we have the traits that we have? Science has given us pretty good answers for all of those. Non-science people have tried to find the answers to those for centuries. They came up with all sorts of bizarre stuff because they didn't understand evolution. Now we know science has told us and helped us understand these wonderful things. So I want to leave you with a feeling that it's been a wonderful trip for me doing this and the act of discovery. And I think one of the most beautiful things that we have is science, which tells us, oh, I didn't know that. And science also gives us the opposite, since we are discovering and we know we don't know things, that the three most important words in the English language, I don't know. Thank you.
Thank you, Gordon. That was a beautiful and inspiring presentation. The questions are rolling in today. I'll go ahead and ask the first one and then I'll get to our list. I guess one of the things that I hadn't thought about before today's presentation is some of the environments you have to put yourself in from a dangerous or athletic perspective with you doing the rock climbing. So maybe tell us a story about your most athletic or your most dangerous mission of discovery.
Well, it actually occurred not with blackbirds at all, but I did a senior thesis when I was an undergraduate at the University of Wisconsin. And I did it on red-tailed hawks and great horned owls, since you had to climb up to all the nests. And I did a lot of tree climbing, and I learned a little bit about rappelling, so I would rappel down the trunks. And I did that, and that was before I was married and before I had kids. And I decided after I became a father that I would not engage in that. And one of the things that attracted me to marsh nesting blackbirds was that all of the nests were less than 2 meters off the ground. And yet I still did a little bit of dangerous stuff, as you saw me climbing the cliffs there for the Bolivian blackbird. I was still a bit careless and stuff. Well, I didn't take any real chances there, but the most dangerous stuff that I actually did was on climbing trees for red-tailed hawks and horned owls.
Nice to see you're a little closer to the ground at this point in your career.
I've gotten more cautious. And you know, with the marsh nesting blackbirds, well, the most dangerous thing was that I would wade around in those marshes and I would get attacked by leeches, and I'd have to scrape off all the blood sucking leeches when I got out of the water. But it really was not very dangerous. It was a bit uncomfortable at times, but not risky.
Sounds good. Our next question is from Al Christians. Al?
Yes, you mentioned territoriality quite a bit. And I think, you know, this is one of the big problems that primates, including humans, have it's really a big problem for us. I wonder if the birds have some way to limit the consequences so that the violence doesn't get out of hand. And the other thing is that, well, if the birds have it and they're descended from dinosaurs and humans have it, does that mean that it's something that goes all the way back and we're never going to get rid of it? Or I kind of perceive a hint in your talk that if you change the roles of the specific sexes within a species, maybe you can get rid of the territoriality or get it under control some way. Do you think that your science says, well, that's the way to moderate the consequences of territoriality in humans, is to change the roles of the sexes?
Well, this is going to require a bit longer answer, unfortunately, but territoriality is probably ancient, but we don't know for sure, but we can see it in the fossils and the stuff like this. But territoriality evolves when you have a defendable resource. So that if you defend some space, you actually get some resources. And territoriality is not universal. For example, swallows are not the least bit territorial. They're feeding on these flying insects and where they are depending on which way the wind is blowing. The food supply is entirely undefendable. So that no swallows are territorial. Against also, the seabirds nesting on a cliff, you may defend a meter around the nest, but the food supply is not defendable because it's out there and there's no way that anybody can gain control of it. So territoriality occurs only where you can gain control of a resource that is sort of reliable and defendable. And it's most of our aggression that involves us is not the simple kind of territoriality that I studied in blackbirds. Human territoriality was not individual. The territories, we were in these small social groups, and the individual groups had a territory, which we communally defended. We had the original heavy competition but among males for females, and we fought a lot for that. And a lot of our aggression is over mates, but it's not territorial. So so much of human aggression does not relate to territoriality in terms of the defensive space. Defensive space in humans and our ancestors was communal, as it is today. The big defensive space is communal, and it's nations battering nations. And we've gone to an enormously different situation, but an awful lot of aggression doesn't relate to territoriality. And there are a lot of the birds that I showed you pictures of, the blackbirds that don't have territories, are defending big space, but they do a lot of displaying. I mean, the birds of paradise, there's no territoriality there. And in some of the places, the birds of paradise, the males compete and do a lot of stuff and fight with one another. And when you see, say, something like the sage grouse, the grouse is on these leks, and the males are fighting, and they're fighting and fighting. There's no territoriality there. The males are wandering around and fighting with one another, and the females are taking a look. And it's driven all the way because all the females are going to get from these guys are genes. But there's no territoriality there. Intense competition, enormous males, but it's not over space. So don't equate aggression with space. It occurs over a whole bunch of reasons. And a lot of human aggression that occurs on our individual levels, not the armies fighting other armies, but a lot of the aggression that occurs among individual males relating to competition for mates, and it doesn't have anything to do with territoriality. Does that help?
Yeah, but Genghis Khan conquered a lot of territory and also has 30 some million living offspring. So, you know, it's be a big football hero and get along with beautiful girls. So the aggression is still related, even though it's between groups, still brings benefits to the individual.
All aggression will be related to some benefits, because aggression is costly. You didn't get hurt. And one of the first rules of aggression in wildlife is don't get into a fight you're likely to lose, because fighting can be dangerous. And so an awful lot of fighting, there isn't any fighting. There's big displays, the red deer and the elk get together and they roar at one another, and they keep roaring. Why did they do all of that? One of the best ways to assess how good the other guy is how deep his roar is and how long he can keep roaring. And if he can outroar you, if you take him on, you're going to lose. So an awful lot of animal displays are relating to just deciding whether or not to get into a fight that can assess, because you don't want to get into a fight that you are going to lose. And so an awful lot of human aggression is too in displays, which, as we know, if you're a pop singer or an athlete or whatever, if you sleep alone at night, it's your own choice, not because of lack of opportunities.
We have a number of questions still to get to. Our next question comes from Sheila. Sheila?
Thank you so much. I was so looking forward to this talk. And what I've discovered is my ignorance. When I saw blackbirds, I thought, oh, now I can find out what these blackbirds are doing underneath my kitchen window as they pick up leaves, first to the left, then to the right, and they lift the leaves and toss them to either side, looking for something to eat, I believe. But they are not blackbirds, now I realize. Are they crows? Are they ravens? I have them all confused. Jeff Strang tried to explain to me, and he's given us a website to look. But tell me about all these different blackbirds.
Oh, well, as I mentioned, a lot of blackbirds are not blackbirds. Among the most common that we have around are the crows and ravens that are quite unrelated. They're have a common answer way back in the earliest birds, but they're quite different. And the blackbirds, the big blackbirds that are on our lawns are crows.
Crows.
And they do not gape. And as you've seen, what they do is to flip the bill sideways, you know, but they also dig in the dirt, but they don't dig by gaping. There are crows. A common crow in Western Europe is the rook that has a long bill. It digs cockchafers out of the dirt. It gapes, but, you know, and that's where the term, it's colonial bleeding crow. That's where the term rookery comes from. A rookery is a breeding area of rooks. Where the herons are together, it's a heronry. My British friends is wondering, you call it a heron rookery? What are you talking about? But the big blackbirds on their lawns here, our crows do not gape. They dig sometimes, but the way they expose is by flipping the bill sideways. There are a lot of the finches that scrape and do various things, but gaping, other than the blackbirds in North America and the imported starling, gaping is pretty much restricted in the New World to blackbirds. Our arctarids.
It's what?
Our arctarids. Okay. You really want to call them arctarids. The family arctaridae, that's the blackbird family. And so if you want to not use a confusing term, say arctarids.
Well, Jeff introduced the word corvid to me. What is a corvid?
Corvid, the crow family is the corvidae. And so the members of that family will be called corvids. And that includes crows, raven, magpies, jays, nutcrackers, widespread worldwide family on every continent except South America. And, well, the jays actually get in South America. So there again, we commonly use the name corvid, and that refers to all the members of the family, corvidae.
Thank you. As a sidebar, I also now learned that when I'm yawning, I'm gaping.
you're not actually forcing it out. Gravity will do most of the opening, which is why most birds don't have a big muscle for opening the bill, because gravity, you're not opening against something, and you have a bigger muscle for closing it, because that's when you're grabbing things, and that's when you really need the force. So I'm sorry you're not gaping when you're yawning.
Jeff and Suzanne had a spirited and informative conversation in chat. Jeff was the MC today in writing. His chats were very good. I was the MC in words. And now Suzanne has her hand up. Suzanne?
Yes, hi there. I've had a chance to be over at Mel here at the refuge there for several years. And the yellow-headed blackbirds, the males were always there. They're at the feeders, none of the females, until I discovered them like 3 years later in another whole part of the refuge, these females. So I know that some come at different times, you hear that. And so how do they get together, and, you know, how does that work out that they seem to travel in their own groups?
Well, many of the blackbirds travel in mixed sex groups, or in many of the migratory blackbirds, the males winter farther north than the females. They're bigger, more robust, they can dig through snow. The yellow-headed blackbird, which is much more high, most of them go to Mexico in the winter. The males come back, although we now have some wintering in eastern Washington, and that's due to the development of cattle feedlots. In the areas where the yellow-headed blackbirds are migratory, the males come first and establish the territories, and they're on these territories, and that's where the females find them. But if you with the yellow-headed blackbirds, there is a shortage of territory, so males defend the limited space, and there are a lot of males that don't get any territory at all, and don't get any females, and so there are a lot of male floaters in red-winged blackbirds in eastern Washington, where I studied them, the floating male population was just as big as the territorial male. And there are all these males, the wannabes, floating around and hoping to find somebody getting sick or some way they can tackle and get rid of them. So with both red-wings and yellowheads, you have a lot of males floating around that don't have territories, and they can come in and tank up on the feeders anytime. And they're not sacrificing anything. And it's a good way to tank up and get back and look and see if you can find a male that's looking sick, and you can challenge him. Once we were putting trackers on some red-winged blackbirds, a little backpack with a little tail down, as though the transmitter, and we let that bird go, and immediately got attacked by a floaters. Look, there's something wrong with this guy. Let's go for him. So that's a little aside, but the females are coming later, and they're with the yellow-headed blackbirds at Malheur. They're on their territories. They don't need to go beyond, and there aren't floating females. Every female who is a breeding age, in which they start breeding at the age one, they all get territory, so they're not all coming to the feeder. You got all these floating males. And in addition, in both red wings and yellow-headed blackbirds, a consequence of the shortage of territories and a lot of non-breeding birds, it takes male red wings and yellowheads 2 years to get the fully adult plumage. I did not show any pictures of first-year male yellowheads or first-year male red wings. You can immediately identify them once you know what they're like, and they're big, and they've got some red and some yellow, but not nearly what the males do. So they take 2 years to get, and almost never does a first-year male red wing get a territory. So there's a whole bunch of consequences that go along with this situation. So the marsh resources are patchy, they're intense, and a fraction of the males get control of the whole thing. And then you've got an awful lot of wannabes that make do with what's much less than optimal.
I'm going to take one last question, and it comes from our newest member, Mr. Paul Gibbons. Paul?
So do different species of blackbirds share a marsh? I remember seeing hundreds of blackbirds with only a few red wings. What's his question?
Okay, yes. In eastern Washington and eastern Oregon, red-winged and yellow-headed blackbirds are breeding in the same marshes. They are interspecifically territorial there. The yellowheads take the hot spots, and where the most insects are available in the outer edge, but also they're coming in from the deeper water to get something to crawl out on. So if you're on the outer edge of a cattail marsh next to the open water, it's a much richer place with many more insects. And that's where the yellowheads go, and they push the red wings off that, and the red wings are on the inner side. So they're both in the same marshes, but not in the micro sense, because the yellowheads kick the red wings out of the places where they want to be.